So, automotive, let's talk cars. Who has a car? Who has a connected car? All right. Then let's dive into it. Little bit about me. I had the opportunity to join the Audi Electronics Venture, the security lab there, in early 2016. And there we do offensive security research for the Audi AG, for automotive components, ECUs, and functions. And I had the opportunity there to combine two of my passions, being security and cars, and was like, yay, let's do this, let's have some fun. Why this talk, why this presentation? I learned some interesting things when I joined the industry, and I thought maybe some of these insights are interesting for you as well, so I came here and give you this little introduction. I have two main parts: an introduction to the industry, to give you a little view into what it's like to build cars, how the industry ticks, and then give you some insights into the testing methodologies, the approach for you if you were to join the industry or would start testing automotive components, which I can only encourage you because there's a lot of fun to be had. Okay, let's talk cars. The automotive industry is evolving in recent years a lot from metal bending industry, where engines, gearboxes, refined suspension and interior were important, towards an industry where connected services and software and this internet thing are more and more important, and are beginning to make the difference between brand A and brand B, and where the user experience and the whole ecosystem will make much of a difference. So there's a lot of change ahead and a lot of interesting times ahead. Then I want to draw your attention to timeframes. Cars are developed in 3 to 6 years. The truth is somewhere in between, 4 to 5 years being the average. And this is far longer time than, for example, your continuous integration environment, where you push new versions of your product every 2 weeks and you introduce new features, you fix bugs, you introduce new bugs. And the automotive industry is nothing like that. Not yet there in terms of agility, which is good sometimes. But yeah, it's getting there. Then usage timeframes are also quite different. When you look at your mobile phone, you change it every 2 years, three, maybe 4 years. Then it's time to upgrade and to recycle the device. A car, on the other hand, is absolutely fine to be used after 5, 10, or even 15 years. So this time frame gives an attacker also a lot of time to find bugs, to develop exploits, or and then maybe to monetize these exploits and use them for their advantage. Then we are selling cars worldwide in different markets. There's Europe, China, the US, and even the whole world. And so we have to deal with a lot of different demands. People expect their content providers to be in the infotainment, like music streaming, and also different legal aspects force you to have a little differences in the cars from market to market. And this also lead you to have different software releases for like China and for Europe, for example. And when you're testing for security issues, you have to keep that in mind that you have to test these different versions of the software. Then there are suppliers. In preparation of an internal training, I came across this statistic that says cars consist of 100 million lines of code, which is considered to be even more than Facebook, the live code base of Facebook. And even an F-35 fighter jet only has like a third of the code base. So these are quite complex systems. And think of suppliers as your third-party codes that you integrate into your software project. You need them, but you also have to trust them in a way that you don't introduce security issues into your product. So you have to be well aware of that, and choosing the right suppliers is key here. All right, then the car and its environment. The car is, as I said, a complex system. It starts with the in-car network where all the ECUs talk to each other. You have your key fob that you use to open your car. You have your mobile phone that you interface with your car. And the car itself talks to the mobile infrastructure via 3G, 4G, 5G, whatever. You have Wi-Fi, Bluetooth. We already heard something about Bluetooth today. So there are experts in every domain who can and will attack all the interfaces that you offer. So every interface that you need on the one hand is a possible entry point on the other hand. Then a few brief words about our security goals, things that we try to protect are safety on the one hand. Of course, we have pretty fast IoT devices, and there better be no remote control feature that you're not aware of. Then we have money and business, where we, of course, protect this new business models that are developed using backend services and also integrated in the core. Then there are data and security laws that you have to adhere. Compliance is a thing, and we value the data of the customers, which is to be protected. And also quality is an important thing, because you expect your super expensive car to have good quality, and also security is a means of good software. All right. Then I want to talk about the development process, which I already mentioned earlier. It's 3 to 6 years. It looks like this. We adhere to this V model, as it's called. And only late in the process, somewhere here, we have actual hardware that we can test. And a lot happens before. So think of this as an security development lifecycle just for cars. So there are a lot of security to-dos that various colleagues in our organization do. And this is where our expertise lies. The pen testing is our contribution, our expertise. And I placed it in between implementation and module tests. And this is because we made best experience or when we're involved pretty early in the implementation phase. So we can give feedback very early to the developers and make sure that the bugs are fixed when you're approaching the release phase. Because if you only are very late involved after this magic 100% software stage, then usually changes are very hard to realize in the software in the project. And also, no ECU responsible person or function responsible wants to be the one who delays the start of production or wants to descope functions because of security issues. So if they have the chance, get involved early in the testing process. All right. Testing. This is where the fun begins. ECU or function, what does that mean? Well, in the earlier times, we were focusing on ECUs being infotainment systems, gateways, body control systems. Where you got an ECU on your desk, and the task was to find vulnerabilities, hack it, break it. And now we're shifting towards a function view. What does that mean? Well, for example, remote lock-unlock feature, where you have your app and you press unlock, that causes a request to the backend. The backend sends an SMS to the connected unit in the car. The unit wakes up, boots, creates an online connection to the backend, polls, is there a job for me? Oh, yes, there's an unlock request. It downloads the request and performs all the necessary unlock steps inside the car. So this is, when you look at the function, you're looking at all the ECUs involved, and usually this creates more work than only looking at one ECU. All right, so if you were to test an ECU, what would you do? And I want to give you some hints, some starting points. There's the diagnostics part of every ECU. If you go to your service garage, they can analyze your ECUs with a tester and see if there are any trouble codes stored. And this is usually done over UDS. This is a specified protocol. You can look it up. It is very well specified. And what you would do is you would identify sensitive functions first. There are scanner tools. There's Python frameworks for doing UDS communication. And you can scan all available functions which are sensitive. Well, there's, for example, write by identifier, write by memory, address, and these are functions that actually modify contents of the ECU memory, and these are considered sensitive. Then there are actuator tests. What are actuator tests? Well, for example, your car has a belt tensioner that makes sure your safety belt is well secured, and you can, with a tester, you can activate this function. And there are a lot of other actuators, and you can activate them. You can start test routines right from your tester. This is done via UDS, for example. Some have security measures, like they require a speed signal, so that some are not available when the car is moving, which makes total sense. But you would test it. You would test whether you can cause any funny behavior or funny situations with these. Then you would test how privilege changes are performed or whether they are enforced. What are privilege changes? Well, there's UDS offers a security access service, which performs session changes. UDS knows this session concept, where normally you are in a normal session, and when you go into a diagnostics session, there's also the extended diagnostics session, which enables even more diagnostic capabilities, or there is, for example, the programming session, if you were to upload a new firmware image. So this usually require a form of authentication, a form of login mechanism. And this is done via the security access service. So the standard doesn't say you have to use the security access, but you can use it. And usually, I think all German OEMs use a form of security access. But the standard also does not say how you use it. And the way it works is it's a challenge response mechanism where the ECU generates a random seed. And then the OEM specifies an algorithm how to compute a response. And this response is sent to the ECU. And if this ECU, if this response matches the expected value, then your privilege change can occur. And what you would test here is the actual seed length, because this is not specified, and the entropy. So randomness is the issue here, and you can test it, for example, using burp. If you have tested session value randomness before, this is basically the same thing. And you would test whether delays are enforced. For failed login attempts, there should be a delay, which makes brute forcing a harder task. And these delays should also survive resets and reboots. These are, for example, starting points where you would start testing. So much for diagnostics. Hardware. Now you would pry open the case of your ECU and start looking around. You start identifying relevant components. Usually they are written some serial numbers or unique identifiers on the chips that are used, and try to identify what hardware are you dealing with. For example, external memory is always interesting. Why is that? Well, you can interface with it. You can try to read from it. You can try writing to it. If you attended the hardware hacking workshop yesterday, you probably know where it's going to lead to. Google is your friend here. When you identified serial numbers, throw them into Google and try to find manuals and data sheets. They reveal a lot of valuable information, what the chip can do, how debugging works. Usually there's JTAG used. UART is often used. And these manuals tell you how to use it. So they tell you which pin of the chip is used for a JTAG connection, and you can trace these pins along the PCB to maybe a connector, or where a connector has been in former hardware versions, and attach to them and use them. The same is true for UART, of course, which is also often used for serial console output. You might find interesting debugging information. Then try to understand what you're dealing with. Is a high security module used, or is the trust zone used for secrets? Often your ECUs require some sort of secrets to function properly. To Does your hardware support secure boot, or does it employ a form of secure boot? And how is it implemented? What does the hardware offer in terms of secure booting? Is it active? Usually there are some fuses that are burnt at the end of line services where secure boot is actually activated. There are some maybe a hash of a private key is burnt into the fuse, and then secure booting is active. Look around the board. Which interfaces does the hardware offer? And try to use all of them. Usually there's a form of CAN, FlexRay, whatever. But there might be more, like Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, USB, etc. And try to use all of them. And then you could think of a glitching attack. Well, they are valid attack scenarios. Think about the UDS security service I mentioned earlier. There have been demonstrated valid attacks against security service. So if glitching is a way to obtain elevated access to the ECU, this might be interesting. Then software. We also analyze software, and in the microcontroller world, this is not so much fun. But you could use, of course, again, the manuals to find valuable hints for the reversing process. Usually software is divided into two parts. There's the bootloader and then the actual application. While the bootloader is a form of standard software from your tier one supplier, and the application is the software that the actual ECU drives in normal mode and that performs the ECU purpose specific tasks. And what would you find there? Well, the bootloader is responsible for flashing, for the whole UDS diagnosis stuff, and you would find signature checks if you have some form of signed software checks, or the login routines, and signature routines and checksumming routines, and the application. There you find some weird state machines, also a lot of checksumming code like 0C16, etc. And how would you start analyzing the image? Well, you can start looking for an SDK. Usually there are SDKs for all kinds of chips, and try to find example code and try to understand how initialization vectors are executed, how interrupts are executed, how the chip boots, and then use manuals, because often there are special registers that have to be set to a magic value, for example, for reflashing. If you want to upload new software, then the bootloader has to set the special control register to a special value, and these instruction sequences are very unique and very specific, and you can pinpoint them very precisely in the image, and you can work your way up from there and pinpoint relevant flashing code. And the same is true for CAN or UART interfaces. They're accessed similar to memory mapped I/O, so they are very distinct addresses that are used, and you can find them easily and work your way up from there in the reversing process to find relevant handlers for external I/O. Then in the microprocessor world, these are usually the more expensive and higher sophisticated ECUs, like infotainment or connected gateways, for example. And these use QNX, Linux, Android, etc. And you're probably familiar with these. And assessing them, finding vulnerabilities there is no different from hacking your router at home, for example. So what you would do is try to understand the boot process. If there's a secure boot process, try to understand how that works, how the chain of trust works. Try to understand which component starts which other component. Map the attack surface and try to find hardening measures. This gives you a good idea about the overall security posture of the system you're dealing with. Also, analyze the network daemons that are running. Correlate listening services, listening sockets to the running process, and identify privileged services because they are usually valuable targets when attacking a system. And also important, understand the update process. If you connect a USB stick or an SD card to this device, usually there's an auto mounter which integrates the file system into the existing file system, and they're mounted always at a specific path. And you can use this path and grab through the entire image and find where these paths are used. And you will find pretty interesting locations where external memory, untrusted input, maybe is processed. All right. Tools of the trade. If you start doing this, off-the-shelf tools are not always super helpful because we're dealing with weird architectures and also pre-compiled code, usually. And therefore, IDA still is our best friend when reversing code. Ghidra recently also joined the stage, but it's not yet quite there in terms of weird CPU support. What else would you need? Well, a multimeter is often quite helpful in beeping out connections from one pin to connector somewhere else. And then some off-the-shelf tools like JTagulator, which can help you identifying how to attach to the JTAG pins correctly. Then if you're familiar with hardware, then you probably know the Lauterbach debuggers. We have them in the company, and also our suppliers use them, so we use them too. These are quite helpful sometimes. Then also we use Bus Pirates, but there are different other tools to interface with onboard components like memory. And then there's, of course, logic analyzers like the Solea. This is what we use, and this is like Wireshark for hardware, where you can point your probes and see what's going on. See whether you're talking to UART, for example. And then there are, of course, internal diagnostics tools that we have that are used internally. We use them too, because they save a lot of time. And then there's your favorite Python tooling, of course. There are numerous CAN frameworks that you can use, and use whatever you like, whatever suits best. Right, little outlook. What will drive the industry in the future? Well, there are legal requirements to secure development coming up. This is WinEC VP29, where you have to prove that you're developing according to best practice, that also your suppliers are developing according to the best practice, and you have to prove, or you have to, get certified to a third party, which is still unknown to my knowledge. But yeah, we will see how it's turning out. Then Card2X, does somebody have a bingo? Card2X, yeah, will come in the future. Cars will talk to each other, will talk to infrastructure, and yeah, this is going to be an interesting, interesting setting. And virtualization of ECUs is also going to be interesting thing, because the trend is going to from having 70 or 100 single ECUs in the car, maybe towards a handful of high power ECUs, and you would then have single virtual ECUs inside these high power hardware elements. And this is going to be interesting because it will also increase development time. Decrease development time. Development will be faster. Also, security testing for us will be easier because you can run the software in virtual environments. And also things like fuzzing will be a lot easier using virtual environments. All right. So much for my introduction. Does somebody have questions?
Okay. Yes. Thanks, Sebastian. I'm handing out a microphone. Maybe I'll start back there.
Hi, thanks for the talk. You mentioned in the beginning the long usage of cars, 6 years, 10 years, 12 years. How do you tackle the problem of security updates of about after 6 years, after 8 years? How do you do that?
Yes, this is indeed a problem. And when security issues arise, of course, we build new software images, and then they are, well, there's a whole board at Audi that decides how to perform software upgrades. Sometimes they're pushed to the service garages, and when your car comes to a service point, then you will get the new software at the next, when the car gets into the garage next time. When it's really critical, then of course you will get a written notice to perform the update.
Hi.
Is that a question? Yeah. Sorry.
In the beginning, you mentioned the term glitching. Could you briefly explain what that is?
Yes. Hardware to function correctly needs a certain current, for example, and a certain voltage to work properly. And there are hardware glitches or errors that occur that cause certain side effects in hardware in microprocessors, for example. So, for example, you can there's several forms of glitching, and you can, for example, do power glitching, where when the CPU is running, you can quickly cause voltage drops, and what this causes, these usually cause interesting behavior in processors. For example, you could skip instructions. So when you glitch at the right time, you could skip instructions or flip certain values in registers, all kinds of weird behavior. And you could, for example, also do EMV glitches, where you're causing electromagnetic pulses, more or less precise, on the die, on the chip. And depending on where you are in the chip, you can cause funny behavior in the chip too. You could also point it to the RAM. You could point it to some processing units inside the chip, and cause hardware failures that you can take advantage of. Does that answer your question?
Okay. Then.
Thanks for the call. I still get messages that the key signal to the car can still be bridged and amplified, so the car thinks the owner sits in the car while it's just the hacker, while the owner is half a kilometer away. Is there a final fix for that now?
Yeah, thanks for roasting me. I think there is a fix. I think they implemented some movement detectors in the key where this function is only active when the key is in movement. So when you have it hanging and at home, this keyless gone feature usually is not active. So this is, to my knowledge, the current solution. But I don't know how it's done for existing cars.
Hi. Sure. There was a question around the firmware updating and software updating. How about hardware? I mean, if you identify a flaw in, like, I don't know, broken trust zones or a need for hardware security module, does that throw back the whole development for a year and you redo the car and add everything that's needed? Or is that just being pushed into the new model and you just leave it as it is and live with a flaw? I just don't know how much does it cost. What do you do? What do you recommend?
Good question. Well, I'm not too much involved into these decision processes, right? But I can't really answer this question. There have been situations where, for example, you have flaws in the ROM of a chip that would that could be used to bypass secure boot mechanisms. And yeah, it's not easy to get vendors to build new chips for you with a new ROM, because sometimes assembly lines for these chips no longer exist because they're already building new other chips. And when the OEM purchases a batch of chips, components, like 100,000, then the manufacturer says, okay, I'll build these 100,000 for you and maybe 500,000 for other customers. And then the assembly line changes to a whole different product. And then they keep these chips in stock and they sell you the chips from the stock. So it's, quite a hard task to get actual fixed hardware when actual flaws in hardware are detected.
Hi. The slide you had about the development process of new cars reminded me of the V model of software development, which is steadily being replaced by more modern, more agile processes. Of course, for cars, there's safety reasons why you slow down. But are there any ways you guys are trying to implement newer, more agile processes into your work?
We do this for backend services. Actually, yes. For code that's in the car, I don't know, certainly not for safety relevant components. But for more customer facing units like the infotainment system, slowly this is coming. So they're like, your mobile phone has apps, and this app concept turned out to be quite cool, and we're adapting this. there's still development in this area.
Okay, thank
it's
you.
More agile.
Sebastian, so we will look forward to the car with a lot of apps and weekly update cycles.
Yeah, me too.
Okay, so if you have further questions, I would ask you to maybe go to one of the breakout rooms outside. Yep. And I think the other speaker room is still available.
So we can continue here with the cyber risks, which is a good introduction for you.
Yep.
Thank you, and a short round of applause.